family, thank you so much for joining me for another episode of Take Me Places. And today I am with one of Jamaica's greatest producer, a man who has shaped the music throughout decades, a man who is responsible for the careers of many of our favorite artists, Buju Banton, Matt Cobra, Marcia Griffith, Vera Simon, just the name of you, Romain Virgo. A man who is also responsible for singles and albums, I mean countless record-breaking records also. We will talk about all of that. But first of all, I want to warmly welcome Donovan Germain. How are you today, sir?
I'm fine. Thanks for having me.
Yes, thank you for taking the time and also inviting us to a special place of your choice. Where are we now and why did you take me to this place?
You're in the lobby of the Penthouse Recording Studio.
Right.
And it's where I'm most comfortable.
Right. This is also where you spend most of your time of the day, I figure.
Yes.
How much of the day would that be?
I'm here from 12 till 7 in the night.
Okay.
If I'm not at Kingston College.
Right, of course. This is something we have to talk about as well, in case you recognize the predominant purple color in the picture. But first of all, we mentioned we are at Penthouse. We're basically in the heart of Kingston, Jamaica. And this is the city that you also grew up in, right?
Yes.
Where were you born and where did you spend your childhood?
I was born about 10 minutes down the road.
Really?
And there is some road on Maxfield Avenue.
Okay.
And grew up there till I was about 12. And then I moved to Pembroke Hall.
Okay.
And from Pembroke Hall to the States.
Okay. Tell me a bit about that time in general. The 50s, the 60s, it was a time when Jamaica got its independence also. How was the atmosphere in Kingston in general like?
Well, you know, that time I was a young man, because 62, I was 10 years old. So I can't remember what, you know, from a standpoint, I was not playing at that time. I didn't really know what's happening politically or economically in the country. And was all I'm doing is looking for the next football to kick. You know, that's what I believe at that time, you know. So most of my young days were spent playing football and going to school, I guess.
Okay. And the school. It is a very important issue, right? The high school you went to is Casey. For those outside of Jamaica who are not familiar with, first of all, the importance of the high school that you go to in Jamaica. Also, what comes with it, the color, for instance. I mentioned the purple, that's Casey's color. Please tell those outside of Jamaica who are not familiar with that a bit about how important high school is in Jamaica and what's that associated with also for like champs and football and those things.
Well, for me, the most important thing about Casey that was originally built to accommodate poor people, kids.
Okay.
So it's mostly the underclass people that, you know, so-called underclass that went to that school, because we weren't allowed to go to the schools that the upper-class people went to, you know. So from that standpoint, I'm very passionate about that, because either really the people that the kid that needs a chance in life, you know, because based on their address, it's a level of discrimination.
Yeah, definitely.
So we have to try and equip them academically or by virtue of their ability to play a sport, that they can at least help to take themselves out of the circumstances that they are living in right now.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why I'm really so passionate about giving back to the school now, because it was really the school that really, you know, really influenced the man that I am today.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I think it's about time that I give back. my purpose right now. Mm-hmm. Still giving back to school right now. My time and finances and in mentorship, you know, because it's critical.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And you're managing also the football team.
And the track team.
Yeah.
Yes, and you know, we have won the track champs, as they call it. And we have won
just recently, right?
And we have won football earlier this year. So we have the major trophies at 2A in our seats right now, which I have integrated back in getting back to the school.
Yeah, well, congratulations
Thank
on that.
Much.
I mean, for those who don't know, outside of Jamaica, champs is where the high schools compete and where young, talented athletes get a chance to showcase their talent in the national stadium, and which is a crazy important hype thing out here.
Exactly. Crazy place. So we look for the champs every year. It's, and it gives you bragging rights. Also, you know, and the thing about it, when you win, it gives the kids they walk a little bit more pep in their step, you know, and you try to get them to a situation where they try and win, because even in life you have to try and win, you know.
Yeah.
That's what made me so successful. You know, that winning mentality from that school, I never go in a situation and I think that I'm not gonna win. Need if I win, I'm gonna get up and try again.
Mm-hmm.
That's the motto of the school: brave may fall, but never yield. So that has been a part of my life.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not gonna yield. Always try.
Wow! So you have that spirit from your school days already. That that is what you learned from there, basically.
Yeah.
You mentioned already living in the States also. So after high school, at some point, you moved to New York.
Yeah.
And you had your first record shop there.
Yeah, I'm actually. It was my first job. It was a part-time job. That when I went to school in the evenings, I came back and did that job on Saturdays, you know. And at some point, the gentleman decided to retire, and he gave me the opportunity to take a store from him.
Uh-huh.
And so that was the beginning of my journey.
Yeah.
Of being self-employed.
So were you already interested a lot in music at that time that you went for that in particular? When did music in general enter your life? Because before you mentioned football, you mentioned school. So
music was in my life from I was about 7 years old, you know. Because when I lived on Nelson Road, there was a sound system that was across the road from me. So, you know, like, normally they play out on a Saturday night, so in the day they string up the sound to make sure the sound is up to scratch. And there also was the place that I heard a lot of new stuff, because like what they call special today, in that time a special was a pre-release song.
Mm-hmm.
So we got to hear the songs before it even became available to the general public. So I kind of developed my love for music and shaped my appreciation for music also. So that when I went to my little disco, that when I played on the school campus and I went to school in the States, you know. So my life was real. Music was always in my life from about 7 years ago till today.
So when did it occur to you that okay, this is really something I want to do on a professional level? And was this something that was back in those days like easy to do, or was it hard to get into that field?
Well, all right. I used to work on Wall Street in the States,
mm-hmm.
right? And at the same time, I had, well, because no back on it. When the gentleman decided to retire, they gave me the record shop. He sold me the record shop. And I remember when I went to my mom and I told her that the gentleman in suspense stuff was retiring and wanted to sell the store, and he gave it the first option. And I remember she sat on the bed and she looked at me and said, "Donovan, you think I can come to America, scrub white people floor, send you to college, and you talk about you want to go into music?"
Mm-hmm.
And at the time, and in retrospect, I can understand where she came from, because what she saw was Rasta and ganja smoking and stuff like that. She never really wasn't, you know, exposed to the business of music.
Mm-hmm.
You know, So, you know, one thing I regretted in my life so far is that she did not live to see the result of the decision I made. You know, because she went to Irish engagement with her, you know, a little level of doubt if the decision I made, because I'm her only child. You know, this decision I made, but even in that scenario, it made me realize that try to support your kids in something that they want to do. You can't live your life through them. It was nice. I think she said, yeah, you're an accountant. I'm going to Wall Street in my jacket and tie every day, and her son is an accountant. Yeah, but that's what her son really happy doing that. You know. So, but when the music gets into your system, it's an addiction. Yeah. Sometimes it's some people chasing it. But I understand. You know, so it gets into your system, you keep chasing it. But at some point, you have to realize, you know, is it really working or is it not working? Mm-hmm. Fortunately for me, it kept on working. That's why I'm here today, like this conversation too.
Mm-hmm.
You know? So, music has always been in my life to this day. Even, you know, to this day, music in my life.
Right. At the time when you started, those were the early 70s. Reggae in general was still a very young genre at that time. Tell me a bit about the spirit in general, about who wasn't involved, and was everybody motivated to do this new thing, to try out this new music, or how was it like?
Well, there's a gentleman, my name is Ken Williams, the disc jockey really in New York. I give him credit for his contribution to what the development of the music in the States, in New York. So what will happen in the 70s, we used to get records from GUSSIE. GUSSIE bought record for us and sent it to the States. And then we take a copy of the record and give it to Ken Williams to play. Those days, I remember it started off for 1 hour at a time, and then we got 2 hours on the radio, till ultimately I saw we got a day, and it got to a week, you know. But it was, you had to have a commitment at the time, and there were some people that were committed to making sure this music worked, myself included. And, you know, I should get up and go to the radio station, make sure they got all the records, you know. At the time, like I said, I decided to go into that business of mixers and do my part to make it work.
Yeah. You know? So was it sort of a pioneer spirit? We are pushing this new thing. We really want to make it to something big. And
you know, at the time, I didn't know what was even the goal, that, you know. We just want you to sound on the radio.
Uh-huh.
You know, and I remember when we went there as Jamaicans, and we tried to bring the culture into America, the system there. Remember, we had with no socks on. And people, you know, say, yeah, Donovan and the socks are a big thing. They won't see a man in the socks. How he's come from Jamaica that way, you know, set up team with that way in the socks, you know. So it was, like I said, I had a commitment to really see this thing work.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And like I said, Ken Williams, I have to give him credit. I remember he brought up all the artists from Jamaica. I remember he brought up the Mighty Diamonds, Black Uhuru. And then you had this club in Manhattan by the name of Negril, where a weekend would be there, you know. So I forgive him, and Gil Bailey again, may so rest in peace. He was another pioneer. He came from London. And then when he spoke this deep Jamaican part of most people probably couldn't even understand. You know? So and these people who really help to really make the music, you know, accepted in the States. you don't know where to get it there, you know?
When you then eventually started producing, you, I think, traveled back and forth. And in the first beginning, you didn't have your own place like you have today, and also not like you used on Slack and Road. Which studios did you used to go to when? What musicians did you work with in your early days?
All right. When I decided to go into production, I was distributing for Miss Sonia Pattinger, I know. So I used her studio, Treasure Studio was the first studio I started using. But I didn't like the environment the studio was in, because really downtown, you know, constant, you know, violence going here and there and so there. So then I moved to Channel One. No, I didn't move to Channel One first. I went to Dynamic Sounds. And then Tough Glam, I used Tough Glam, and then I used Channel One.
And eventually you got your own place on the upper floor, that penthouse actually on Slipe Road.
You know the story why I got a studio, because initially I was quite content with coming to Jamaica and set up office and stuff like that. But I remember I used to like rent the studio for a month, Dynamic Sounds.
Yeah.
And
spend there every day of that month?
Yes, for that month, yes. Wow. Because I lived abroad, so I could come. At that time, if you rent a studio for a day,
yeah,
and you can't get the studio for another 2 weeks, because there's constantly renting.
Yeah.
So I remember I rented the studio for a month. With other plans came in, and I went to the studio, and Baronese band, Never Lines. They were already making some calypso songs, you know, soca songs. But I thought it was just, they were running late, only to be told that my time was cancelled because they wanted to make this soca. And it kind of pissed me off, because I'm supporting the thing, and if that situation presented itself from a professional standpoint, could I call and say, well, you know, something happened.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But I just went there, prepared an artist, musician, and just told that I can't just do it.
Yeah.
So I just figured that, well, you know, I have a control of my destiny.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm not an idiot. So I just decided that, well, I'm going to start build my own studio. Nobody can really dictate when I can be my creative.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so that's how I ended up building penthouse.
Mm-hmm.
And again, also, when I went there and I did the distributors, I gave, you know, distributors my songs, and every quarter I see the same amount of money and the royalty statement, and I'm thinking, whoa, why? You don't have to save amount of money on this royalty statement.
Mm-hmm.
I remember I went there with the Sonic Songs, Never Leave. And they had put on a third floor on his building. I was talking and he was nonchalantly said, penthouse, put on that, you know. And I'm saying to myself, penthouse, put on that. And I'm at a place, a family-owned place where I was. I don't own anything. And I put on a floor. And so my talent put on.
Mm-hmm.
And I decided there and then that I was going to be shooting my own stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So I took away. The first time I started this shoot was Smoochie Batman's Murder.
Mm-hmm.
And from that one song, it covered all the royalties that I would have gotten for 3 months elsewhere.
Yeah.
You know? So, you know, there's the politics of Jamaica. It's not even a topic too. And then, you know, after started getting presses, my records.
Awesome, right. Yeah.
Awesome. So, I get another record press, but once it come around to Independence, Easter, Christmas, you can't get the record press.
Right.
Because at the time, people buying records, but the pressing plant are also distributors, so they're pressing their stuff.
Okay.
So, again, it forced me to a position to say, okay, again, you're not going to control my destiny. I'm going to set a pressing plant for myself. Mm-hmm. And that when that's the person can't. Yeah. Sure, but I to remiss of me to have someone control my destiny, but I can't get things done when their things can't be done. So yeah. Besides that, I feel it anybody.
Mm-hmm.
I just move on.
Yeah.
You know? So that is the journey. So where we are sitting here today.
Yeah.
You know?
I mean it's been a long road, and you just mentioned Buju.
Mm.
With him you did that record breaking record that I mentioned also in the beginning, Mr. Mentioned, the best selling album of Jamaican music history.
Mm.
How did you first meet Buju? What did you think when you heard his voice and you heard his skin?
This engineer had Stumpy kept telling me about this song. It was by Portmore's big song in Portmore by this artist, Buju. And he kept saying, you know, you need to listen to this artist. So I was saying, you know, he came and I wasn't there when he came. But when I came in, my engineer DFK played this song for me, Man for Dead. And I remember I went into my office and just listening, because I'm a person like that. I just sink in the background and listening and observe.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember I called Diva. And I called him and I said to him, you know, you're really talented, you know, but you need to, the kind of songs you need to make. That is not the kind of song you really want to make. But, so we went in the studio and just watch over you perform. And one thing that really impressed me was that he was always prepared.
Mm-hmm.
He put a rhythm on the board, and he would go in his back and take a little book and go through the things, found that something fit there.
Mm-hmm.
So to me, that showed me a person that is prepared,
mm-hmm.
you know, and he was committed to the craft,
mm-hmm.
and he was willing to learn, you know. So those qualities that build support are being successful. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It was about him going on time. He was saying, "Go, go, go." It's about the business too. The business too. That I realized, you know, by our discussion that everything starts from this little place here.
Right. Just, you know, yeah.
Whatever you see happening outside in the street, it has to start from inside here.
Right.
So you have to make sure it's here. All the work is done inside here, and you can go out and get the accolades outside. You know? Mm-hmm. So it was always, you know, prepared.
And how important is the personal aspect for you when you work in a studio with people? That you have a vibe with people and the atmosphere is right.
See, you asked me where, the first person that asked me was where, why. This is a very critical area in the studio. If I cannot have a relationship with the outside here, mm-hmm. I don't want to use it.
Oh, okay. So you would not be working with someone who just says, I want to work in your space or whatever, if you not
feeling the person.
That connection with them.
Not doing that.
Mm-hmm.
Not doing that. We have to have a relationship outside, that we can come here and sit here early and chat and you know, learn about life.
Mm-hmm.
Before you go in the studio, because at the same time, by a virtual conversation, I'm teaching you the business.
Mm-hmm.
So when you go outside and 10 people start telling something in your ears, you need to have a balance to make a move in that organization, because by a virtual conversation, I've been sitting here, you have an appreciation of what we do,
mm-hmm.
and how things might not happen.
Mm-hmm.
One of the worst things you can do for me as an artist is walk inside your studio and tell me that you have a number one song. You tell me that my response is go and record it for yourself. Go record it for me.
Mm-hmm.
Because I don't know to make a number one song.
Mm-hmm.
I just know to try and make a song that makes sense and try to do it professionally, make the engineer detail based as possible, but ultimately we put it out there with the fans and the public that makes the hit. So I can't say I'm going to make a number one song, but if I could I make a number one song, I just come in here with me, make a song and have my yacht outside and meet the summer's gone, my yacht and I'm hanging out doing some nice girls, sleepily clad girls and having a good time, and tomorrow I come, can make another number one song, go back and think. That's not possible. I don't want to hear that. Mm-hmm. About your number one song for me. Keep it. Because let's try and have a good song.
Yeah. And I mean, when we look at the pictures that we have here in the background and also in this very room, we can also see that this is beyond just the studio works, right? You and Marcia and Romain and Buju and all the people that are in the pictures. So you must have a personal relationship with them, even outside of the space,
it's
right?
It's very important. Very, very important to have that kind of relationship. Because, and you see, again, when you have that kind of relationship, you go in the studio. Whatever decision we made inside the studio to the song, it's easy because people know where the relationship outside you transcends the studio. Mm-hmm. You know, feeling if I say, I don't like that, and that is not anything personal.
Okay.
They know that it's a rule channel. Oh, are we going to try and fix it?
Because I was just about to ask you that. Does that clash sometimes when you're somewhat working with your friends,
no,
but you're doing professional music on one side, and then you have to be critical, or you have to say something?
No, that's the thing. They have no problem with that.
Okay.
Even the great bears, man. But sometimes some people, some producers go down, they start to sing, and they can't say anything to me. When I record them, they might tell you, say, no, I don't like that.
Mm-hmm.
I want the harmony there, but you might want the harmony somewhere. What is that? The trust factor.
Mm-hmm.
That's involved, and we say, okay, I will do it that way.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so that comes from a relationship outside. But so if you just walk in and go inside, don't walk in that ego. I'm trying to eliminate that little emotion, that little devil. You know, so we're trying to eliminate that. So we go inside here. One call, we'll try and make a good sound.
Mm-hmm.
You might have to have differences in your opinion and how we make one thing, but the trust factor is what ultimately will make us arrive at a decision that both of us are comfortable with.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. We mentioned reggae and the early days of reggae at some point in this interview, and then we spoke about misdimension. So we are at dancehall also, and you were there when dancehall kind of emerged. You were shaping this music as well. How were the early days of dancehall like, and who would you say were the people that also influenced that highly, and how it progressed in the beginning?
You know, when people ask me that question, and I have one answer, and you know, and I get beat up for it.
Really?
I don't really care. I tell them a dancer, stop with Dave Kelly.
Uh-huh.
Because to date, I don't hear any producer that make a sequence of songs that Dave Kelly has made in dancehall.
Mm-hmm.
You go to any of these retro parties, you go hear those songs, and people be jumping, different generations be jumping to these songs.
Right.
So it must have been a reason why these songs are infectious even to this day.
Timeless time,
There you go, transcends time.
Mm-hmm.
So to me, Dave Kelly, one of my students, and a different generation, and whilst I was doing the reggae, doing the other things that the generation would do. So again, like I said, you have to encourage the other person and support them what they're doing. I didn't say, well, I don't like that kind of music. I like it in a change from what we're doing. But we have to appreciate change, right? But at the same time, the change must have some quality, you know.
Mm-hmm. Definitely. Yeah.
Yeah, it can't change the change sake. Because right now, we're going to change the change sake. Right now, and a lot of sound with no quality out here, you know, lasting for 6 days.
Yeah.
Some, I think 6 days and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Yes. So you still hear that, you still hear the 90s, the late 80s, 90s, and still dominate when you're going to these retro parties.
Yeah.
You might hear, not saying that there was any songs made after that, you know, but a consistent sequence of songs.
Yeah.
You know, everybody looking for my old songs to come out. That you have no such thing since my old.
Yeah.
You know, and I dare anyone to come and prove otherwise to me. I might like you, you're not saying because I might think of the car, DFK is my student. But it's a reality. You know, we have to be, I tell people for that we have to be true to the music. When I, because the music has made, give me a good life and take me out of the world, so I have to be true to it.
Yeah.
You know?
But one thing that you mentioned, would you say that today, also the short attention span of the audience is also a problem for the music, that people have to constantly put out release stuff because otherwise they feel like they are lost or coming off the radar of people.
What has disappeared from the music is objectivity.
Mm-hmm.
So when an artist goes to the studio to do something, there's a level of emotional attachment to it.
Mm-hmm.
If he's by himself in that studio doing the work by himself, that emotion is going to be the dominant force in that. What's happening?
Yeah.
Dominant factor in the whole thing. But when the producer comes into the thing and looks at it objectively,
yeah,
that is where they find the balance in the whole process. That has gone to the music. Now, it's not everybody about the computer and the house and then make a good thing and the thing they're doing properly and they have them friend playing the song because they're from a generation and then friend can play that song and then friend really can play that song. They can play the song not based on the quality of the song but based on the friendship they have.
Yeah.
So ultimately, what do you think will happen? You know? You see, as a producer, my generation come from a place of having to make sure that things is done properly because we pay for the studio time.
Yeah.
While these people not pay for studio time, they're going to buy some cookies and then just spend the day and make some good things and there and go down out in the street.
Yeah.
So we have to pay, so we have to make sure so the thing we do is good and we can recoup the money that we outlay for the song. Mm. They don't have a problem now.
Yeah.
They're not, you know. Still want to pick them finger and then 5 minutes time you're in the street.
Mm.
You know, so. But I'm hopefully, this will get past that.
Mm. Yeah. You are from a different generation as a producer.
Mm.
You are also from a listener perspective.
Mm-hmm.
Because you are also a person that collects a lot of vinyl.
Yeah.
You are a man who really is actually hands-on with the material.
Yeah.
Please tell me a bit about that passion of yours.
Well, that remember, all right, I worked in a record store in the States.
Right.
So that,
so that was back until
of
then.
Course, yeah, man.
So that's what, 40, 50 years old?
That's in 1972.
Right.
And so that became a part of me to buy records. And even though if you go in there, it's like a package of CDs, like a big, you know, I buy records, I support music.
Mm-hmm.
And I listen to a lot of the 70s, 80s songs because I think that is one of the most creative times in the music industry.
Mm-hmm.
In the 70s and early 80s.
And what genres would you listen to?
I listen to R&B, soul sound, I listen to disco. You know, I listen to old reggae songs, then. I call it them. You know, because what it does, you know, when you keep listening to those songs, like I said, the most creative time. There was the melodies of these people were so sweet. So you find that my version of Hitchcock still listening to that. You can ask the engineer when I'm inside the studio working and someone come and start singing. If the melody not grabbing me up, as move on, because the middle is not sweet enough to hold me. Uh-huh. Understand me? Sometimes I wonder, I arrived at this decision so quickly. That came from when you're in a record store and 20, 30 people inside here. You only have 30 seconds to really play a song, uh-huh. to sell that person a song. So you did a knockoff. Being able to identify a song, good melody, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm.
So that is coming. Something catches you.
Yes, right.
Indoors,
right.
30
seconds. Indoor 30 seconds. Mm-hmm. So another thing that I myself, like I said, a listener. I just don't go in there as a producer, you know. I go in there as a consumer too.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Because
okay.
I remember when I used to work in Wall Street, you know, and when I came out of that place in the night and in the winter, and that cold breeze came out of the river and I'm coming to work 2 o'clock in the night. And I'm saying, wow. So when I go in a studio now, then when if that pain in that winter time, I have to work for the money. Mm-hmm. I'm saying to myself, would I subject myself to that kind of element and then come and take my money and buy that song?
Mm-hmm.
If that song really, that sacrifice you're making in that call, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So would I take my money and buy that song? And if I said to myself, say I would buy that song, and make
mm-hmm.
that song.
So can you, when you listen to your records, like in your office, for example, can you really just kick back and just listen to the song, or would you always kind of still be the producer and listen to some technical aspects of it?
No, I don't do that.
No?
Mm-hmm. I have a friend of mine.
Just enjoy.
I have a friend of mine that lives away in Ulaba. Every Sunday, I go over there and I walk with my laptop. Because a friend of mine, and he's part of the management of the football team
mm-hmm.
in the school. And every Sunday, I'm over there from 9 o'clock until 5, 6 o'clock in the evening.
Mm-hmm.
And I hook up my computer and just listen to music.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing, nothing technical, that's just my downtime
mm-hmm.
listening to music from the 70s. Come on.
I'm very happy to hear, though, that aside of your professional work, can still just enjoy music.
Yeah, enjoy music, man.
Nice.
Love music.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like I said, I have to love it because that is what made me who I am,
mm-hmm.
and, you know, and continue to support me.
Yeah.
So I have to love it and respect it.
Yes. You mentioned how music opened doors for you, and you at the same time, you also opened doors for others, because outside of your musical work and outside of then football and all the things you do, you also do a lot of philanthropic work that a lot of people
mm-hmm.
don't know about.
Mm-hmm.
So would you mind telling me about what you do there?
Mm-hmm. What do I have? The going there, unless you're in the situation, sometimes you're busy doing things outside and not really realizing other people's predicament or position they are in right now.
Mm-hmm.
So I went down, decided to go to the school and start to give back. And, you know, so like sometimes some spirit have to make a contact with somebody. So there's two players on the younger, under 15 size, that they need to come on and make a bigger pursuit to go home and stuff like that. So,
mm-hmm.
I said, let's sit down and have a conversation with you. And before I even get there, so when I first decided to go to KC and become a part of the management of the football program, after 22 players in the squad, and just by having a conversation with them, at least half the squad didn't even know where the father was.
Mm-hmm.
So you realize that there's no male imprint. And I'm not to believe that women alone can't grow male kids. It's like, it doesn't make sense. Because there are certain things that we as men instinctively do and think. You have to be able to impart that on a boy child.
Mm-hmm.
You as a female can impart that on
mm-hmm.
a boy child.
It needs sort of a balance also.
Yes.
And
you've been nurturing. and we prepare them for life. Mm-hmm. That's a man, the thing that we have to, you know, be exposed to. Mm-hmm. So I realized the predicament down there. Like I said, I decided, all right, I'm going to mentor two kids at a time. The first one I went was he was a bad boy at the football team, but he was also the captain, very talented, but come from a situation where, you know, garrison, so they have a garrison mentality. So it took a time to really get him around to show him another side of life. Mm-hmm. He probably wouldn't be exposed to without my intervention. Mm-hmm. And he's now playing professional football for Munchy. He does piece, I know, fiction in Jamaica, national side, football side. So that just shows you that you have to be mentoring, try to put them on the right trajectory. Mm-hmm. Because if you don't do that, it is so easy, but they've been there, so you give them a go. Mm-hmm. And say, you know, that is going for me. Mm-hmm. Well, you have to have something to say, do it a different way. Mm-hmm. You might be living in the garrison, but you don't have to behave that way. You can't get a different exposure but until you can change the circumstance. So I've been doing that every year. But, you know, presently I have two of them, two boys, live here in the house at the studio here, because they come from the country and we brought them up to play football. So they stay here, give them all the amenities to probably show that they probably wouldn't be exposed to where they're coming from. And then I have two boys now that the under 16 where they sent to school, people give them lunch money and bus fare every week. And one of the things that really threw me a curveball, I woke up one morning at 5 o'clock in the morning, I took up a phone before I went to walk in. And on the kid, he WhatsApped me and said, "Mr. Jermaine, I don't know what I would do if you didn't come into my life." Wow. And I'm saying to myself, this kid get about 5 o'clock in the morning. Mm-hmm.
To tell you this,
tell me that at 5 o'clock in the morning, they know the impact, mm-hmm, that you have had on this kid. You know? So it really, where you're going on a merry way in life, but there's people that need help. You know, incidentally, the reason I'm actually late for this interview is that I'm going to just have the same conversation going on a purpose, a critical word in our life when we start the place, you know? And I'm just saying to him that you found your purpose, but it's how you articulate the purpose, mm-hmm, you know? Because so I'm trying to make you understand that the message can be very good. How do you communicate this message,
mm-hmm, right,
to,
yeah,
the people?
Yeah.
Because you can have a good message and how you communicate it get lost, and people might have an adverse reaction to the message because of how you deliver it.
Yeah.
Although the message might be making sense for you.
Yeah, right.
So these are things that I was up here with him for a while, having this discussion with him, because he's developing a passion now that he reached a point that, like you say, he's financially secure, he can't really speak his mind without the repercussions, mm-hmm, you know? But like again, it's how you're going to deliver the message.
Yeah.
So I try to get people to understand that. You still have to be politically correct, but you don't want to be like like a politician, not to say, you know. But yeah, you can, you did a way to communicate your vision. And I can say, you have a vision, so you need how to communicate this vision.
Yeah.
You know? So that's why I was really interested. Yes, but it's a purpose. Yeah, so my being a case, you know, that is my purpose. It makes you want to get up early in the morning to go there. Mm-hmm. You understand me? And there's a level of appreciation here that I have never gotten in music.
Wow, okay.
You understand? So you know the accolades that they give you and things like that, is a genuine appreciation.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Comes for you to get up at 5 in the morning.
Yes. Yes.
That's a different level.
Of yes. A different level of appreciation. You know that you really make that impact in a child's life. Mm-hmm. You know? It blew me away.
Yeah.
I can't stop telling this story to the headmaster, should the headmaster, and he said, you know, say, boy, you know, you like know, the impact that you make in school. So much so that the headmaster, I can't go in that school and do anything. The headmaster said to me, all I have to do is make certain that he knows what I'm doing, that in case somebody asks him, he can say, yes, I'm aware of it.
Mm-hmm.
But he gave me the authority to do what he makes me to get done, go ahead and get done. And that is all for free, like, I didn't pay for it.
Right.
And I'm doing it very quietly. And
yes,
I'm not looking at any fanfare or anything like that.
Mm-hmm.
That is just my purpose now. I'm not going to say that.
I'm very happy to hear that you are in this position to give back in that way and to experience that appreciation. I can assure you, though, that you reach with your music also millions of people who just are just as grateful for what you produced and created together with these amazing artists. So we are well appreciative of that at the same time. You know?
Thanks. But, you know, like I said, I find my purpose now.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
When I came to music, I love music. The accolades, those things were never in my mind, ever. Mm-hmm. I just want to make a song. I just want to give a young artist a chance.
Mm-hmm.
That's what, you know, the history of Penthouse. Young people.
Yes, exactly.
Young people.
Fostering their career from the very beginning. Mm-hmm.
I have Penthouse has trained the most engineers in this music industry. Mm-hmm. I can say that to anybody. The most engineers
mm-hmm.
in this out here, all the world do it, a lot of them were trained at Penthouse. The amount of NSTM speakers that they mess up and in the process of learning. But like I said, somebody gave me a chance.
Mm-hmm.
So I give young people a chance though. Because when people gave me a chance, I was not experienced personally. Right?
Mm-hmm.
Then the father saw something in me
and
gave me the opportunity.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just passing it down.
Yes. And see where this has gotten to from your humble beginnings, you know, to where we are today. And at the same time, the people that you gave a chance and helped to start their career. So, Donovan Germain, I thank you very much for inviting me to your space here, sharing your history and your wonderful stories, and giving us a bit more insight on the wonderful works that you do for. So for all of those, whether that be music or the KC work, the philanthropy work, I wish you all the very best for that. And thank you so much for this interview.
You're welcome.